Mother Nature has concocted a potion of wind, rain, and cold, making today's Ivy League presentation a battle of survival as well as a test of football ability. Yale University has shaped American football as we know it today, introducing the line of scrimmage and the forward pass. Yale has scored more points, won more games, spawned more All-Americans than any college in the country, among them Brian Dowling and Calvin Hill. And for 76 years, the Yale Bowl has been the centerpiece of this historic tradition. The 80s have seen some extraordinary finishes in the Yale-Princeton series. 1986 final minutes. Bulldogs score 11 points in 62 seconds, stun the Tigers on John Duryea's field goal. Carm Cosa's been a part of this rivalry for a quarter century.
It's our last home game. It's the game the seniors will remember the most, played at home. And it also is a part of the Big Three championship.
Princeton's had its moments in this rivalry. Gives the Tigers new life at the one-yard line, and quarterback Bob Holly would not be denied. He capped a come-from-behind victory with a one-yard touchdown plunge. Head coach Steve Tosches knows the significance of this game well.
The Princetonians still talk of the Big Three championship each year and competing for it. It's an important football game, there's no doubt about it.
The Yale Bowl in New Haven, Connecticut. This is the way it should be. College football and the elements in the month of November. Today, it's the Princeton Tigers and the Yale Bulldogs. Take a look at the standings. Cornell and Dartmouth going for the title. Yale still has a chance entering the final 2 weeks. Princeton cast in the role of spoiler. Hi, everybody. I'm Wayne Larrabee with Kevin Guthrie. This should be a lot of fun here this afternoon in the mud and the rain of the Yale Bowl. The Big Three championship, we heard the coaches talk about it. It's Harvard, Princeton, and Yale. And what makes this rivalry so special?
Well, you know, all these teams want to win the Ivy League championship, but behind that is the Big Three. The Big Three has been a tradition that's gone for many, many years. Back to the days when the Ivy League teams, these two teams, Harvard and Yale and Princeton also, were the big teams in the nation, nationwide powers. Now, Yale has faced Harvard and Princeton to finish their season in every year since 1898.
Well, you know, Carm Cosa, the 25-year head coach at Yale, has constructed his offenses around personnel, not philosophy. The people he has on campus. He has a gutty senior quarterback by the name of Darin Kehler that he's constructed a wishbone around.
Surprised everyone last year going to the wishbone. He was very effective and went on to win the Ivy League title. Darin Kehler is the key. He's been injured some this year. You see, in the five games when he's been healthy, they've averaged 222 yards on the ground and 27 points. In the other three games when he's been hurt or missed the game, only 157 yards and just 10 points.
Now, the defense for Yale has really struggled pretty much all season. It's young and it's been injury-riddled this year.
It has. They've lost a linebacker practically in every week. All four of their starters have been hurt at some point. And symbolizing this is their captain, one of only two returning starters a year ago, Chris Gaughan. Chris Gaughan is a great player, but he's been banged up all year, and it's really hurt their defense.
And the defense will face a solid Princeton ground game, led by a surprising sophomore, Eric Hamilton.
I think Eric Hamilton surprised everybody, including Coach Steve Tosches. You know, he's come into the season, he's had three 100-plus yard games, and in those three games, Princeton has won. He's the leading candidate right now for Ivy Sophomore of the Year.
And defensively, Princeton not spectacular, but solid, and they're led by a senior in the secondary at the Tiger back position in Mike Carew.
Mike Carew is the captain. It's very rare to see a defensive secondary player being a captain of the team. That's a testament to the respect that this team has for him. On the other side, Carm Cosa says, this guy is a hitter, and he doesn't back away from anybody. A lot of respect from other coaches, too.
All right, we've got one of those days for college football. Great day in the elements here in New Haven, Connecticut. And we'll return after these words. Wayne Larrabee, Kevin Guthrie, Princeton Tigers, and the Yale Bulldogs, our Ivy League presentation. We mentioned the elements. Yeah, it's kind of stormy, to say the least. Temperature, though, get up to about the 50s. 52 degrees expected to be about the high. And we are in the 100% chance of rain. It's been raining all morning. Coach Steve Toshes, fourth season of Princeton. And Coach Carm Koza in his 25th year at Yale. 26th season overall, 25th year here at the with the Bulldogs. There's the kicker, Chris Lutz. And Maurice Sa, who last week ran back an 82-yard kickoff for a touchdown.
You know, Wayne, last week I worked the Colorado-Nebraska game on the sidelines. The weather was exactly like this, except maybe 15 degrees colder. There were four fumbles in the first half, and the kicking game played a big role, and as well, the wind played a huge role in the ballgame.
There's the approach and the kickoff. It is Callahan with some open field out across the 25 to about the 28-yard line, and it's a first down. Lutz, the kicker, among those on the stop. Take a look at the offense for Yale. The quarterback is Kehler. We talked of him. Chris Corey is a key at fullback. A good blocker, tough runner. Callahan and Gavea, pretty good quickness on the flanks of that wishbone. Shabazz, the wide receiver. Warner is the tight end. And we'll get to, there's the center, Chris Michalik. We'll get to the rest of them in a moment. First down, they mark it at the 29-yard line. Darin Kehler on the option. Going to take it himself for a first down. Out across the 45 to about the 47-yard line. First down on the first play of the from scrimmage. 18 yards on the gain.
Yale running a lead option. That is, they're going to block the defensive end. You see Leon Newsom get blocked, and Kehler just goes almost like a sweep. Sees the outside open and goes up the field. They got a good block on Leon Newsom. Kehler didn't have to pitch the option, just ran it upfield.
Rest of the lineup for you when we get an opportunity. Here we go. Rob Michalik is Chris's twin brother. Dave Russell, the other guard, and Allen and Johnson. Johnson, the biggest player on the offensive line for Yale. First down. Kehler. Callahan. Taken out of bounds into the mud in front of the Yale bench on the near side. Mike Carew, the co-captain, on the stop. Princeton defensively. Schultz and Ryan are tough up front. Charity and Newsom make bookend defensive ends. They are both good size and quickness. Cisco and Harris on the inside of the linebacking core. Freeman, one of the leading tacklers on the team, plays on the outside. They'll move him around. Bevan and Williams are the cornerbacks. Williams, an excellent athlete. Haru, we talked of him, and Crossett is the center fielder in the deep secondary. Corey, the fullback, for a quick hitter up the middle on second down, and he is close to the first down. He had to get just inside the 45 of the Princeton Tigers.
Now, Yale will often run a triple option, or they'll run a double option. And when I say that, the quarterback actually puts the ball in the fullback's belly and looks to see if it's open before he hands in the ball. He'll read the defensive line. That play, it looked like it was just a straight drive dive play. But sometimes you'll also see the double option. They won't fake to the fullback. They'll just run to the sideline and pitch to the halfback on the outside.
Third down at inches now coming up. You see the big Y and the P painted on the field here. This is the final home game for Yale. They break the bone. Callahan, first down and more, down to the 40-yard line. Ryan, make that Leon Newsom on the stop. Ryan was also there in the vicinity. First down at the 40-yard line. This is the opening drive of the ball game. Kevin Callahan had a good season running the football out of the wishbone for Yale. And we pointed it out in the early portion of the show, right in the open, that boy, what a difference Kehler makes in the lineup for Yale. From the 40 on first down. Kehler rolling on the option. Elects to keep it himself and picks up about 4 yards. I mentioned what a difference he makes, Kevin, because the yardage difference, under 200 yards of offense without Kehler in the lineup, and over 200 yards with him in the lineup in terms of points as well.
Well, Haru's a key player too. Look, he takes the tight end straight on, right off the line of scrimmage, keeps his shoulder parallel, fights off the block, and makes the tackle on Kehler. Great job by Haru, outmatched physically in terms of size on that play, held his ground and made the tackle.
Second down coming up. Gouveia hit from behind by Charity and then driven down. Haru also supported from the secondary. And again, Yale will face another third down.
In the beginning of this series, Princeton's defensive line was getting beat a little bit on the line of scrimmage, but you see great penetration by Charity. Fights off the block and gets into the backfield. Then he gets a help from the pursuit. Princeton's defensive line is going to have to force the action, getting penetration in order to stop the wishbone offense.
There's a look at the young man. Renard Charity, senior out of Richmond, Virginia, number 75, third down at 6 now for Harvard. Make that for Yale. Kehler got Warner over the middle and a first down inside the 25-yard line. Mark it near the 22.
Well, they catch Princeton in a zone defense, zone pass coverage, a little play action, holds the linebackers. Now what Warner will do, he does a nice job of settling. He's in the lower left corner of your screen. He sits down. You see he's just standing perfectly still. He felt an open area in the defensive zone. Kehler saw him, made the pass, and he got the first down.
First down for Yale. This series, Yale will close with Princeton today and Harvard next week up in Cambridge. Quick hitter by the fullback, Corey, and not a lot there, man. I tell you, the defense has to honor the honesty of the fullback in terms of this offense because Corey makes yardage as well as anyone in that offense, and he's a big key for this Bulldog team.
Well, it's kind of an unusual coincidence. Corey, the fullback, has 84 carries for 360 yards. Kevin Callahan, the tailback, or the halfback in the wishbone, has the exact same numbers, 84 for 360.
Second down coming up. First drive of the game. Kehler runs into stiff resistance. That time he ran into big Leon Newsom, a junior out of Towson, Maryland, 6'5 and 270. There's a penalty marker down on the offensive line.
Flag was thrown late after the play. You know, that play was an interesting play in that Yale is starting to flex their tight end. They're lining their tight end up, and we'll go down to the official for the call.
Dead ball, personal foul, defense.
Well, I don't have to tell you, that's about as dumb a penalty as you can get. Your defense starting to play well, makes a couple nice plays inside on and forcing a third down situation. Now you give Yale a first down, half the distance to the goal inside your own end. But what I was going to say is Yale is showing a lot of respect for Mike Haru. They're lining up their tight end, Stu Wilson, in a flex position about 5 yards away from the tackle. That's something we haven't seen. That's allowing Stu Wilson to get out there and block Haru. You see, he lined up about 5 yards outside the tight end. Now watch late. There's the late hit. Number 87, Peter Austin, gets hit late.
This is Callahan. Good tough run inside the five. Jim Freeman made the stop. Second down coming up now. Take a look at what Yale does in plus territory inside the 20. They scored 91% of the time. And they're in close now, just outside the 1 yard line. Kehler sets up his offense. Kehler gonna keep it himself for the touchdown.
You know, option teams love to go to the option when they get down near the end zone because they've got their premier player, their quarterback, with the ball in his hands and an opportunity to make things happen. He can pitch it. He can run it. There's a perfect example of it right there. You get Kehler going down the line of scrimmage. He's looking for an opening at any point where he can dive into the end zone. He doesn't have to pitch it. He sees the opening, and he dives in for the score.
Ed Perks for the point after. Kick 19 of 19 this season. And he puts this one through, making it 20 of 20. And the Bulldogs have scored first to start the ball game. 9:58 left to go, first period. Yale on top.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, It is unrivaled.
Watch the option coming down the right side of the line of scrimmage. Watch very closely the plane of the end zone. Darin Kehler comes out, decides to cut it inside. Now watch, as he goes toward the end zone, it looks like he's down before the ball crosses the plane of the end zone. Very close call. I'm not sure the officials got it right, but it doesn't matter. 7 points on the board for Yale.
Darin Kehler capping that drive. 5:02 off the clock to open the ball game. Very impressive and no mistakes. Turnovers are going to play a role.
I tell you,
in a game like this with two teams that like to run the ball on a field like this, it could play a big role, but that was a flawlessly executed drive by Kehler.
Really was. It's done very well. But, you know, you wake up on a morning like this. You know, these guys, you think football players are tough and they like to get out and get dirty. But you wake up on a morning like this, you're a human being. You're not real excited about going out on the field. I guarantee you that.
I think the linemen like it better than you skill people. Kevin, of course, was a great wide receiver at Princeton. Here's the kickoff by Ed Perks. Lurch. Into the clear for a moment across the 30 out near the 35. Daryl Simchak made the stop for Yale. Joel Sharp has struggled at times this season at quarterback for Princeton. Callahan and Hamilton solid in the offensive backfield. Hamilton, and we mentioned him, he's been a surprise. Baker and Rogers have an inconsistent season at wide receiver. Marin Jaya at tight end. And we'll get the offensive line for you in a moment. First down for Joel Sharp and company. Hamilton on a halfback option pass going deep. Pass a bit too far for Mark Rogers, the wide receiver, to catch up with it. Second down coming up. A little razzle-dazzle to start the first offensive play from scrimmage for Princeton. Finish it up with Todd Crockett at the center position. They've reshuffled this line for Princeton. Cecia and Davis are the guards. Lowry and Tice form the tackle combination. Second down and 10. Single back offense now. Sharp running an option. To the outside. Risaw makes the stop on the play on Chris Hallahan, the fullback, a senior from Hackensack, New York, who came in with 301 yards rushing. He and Hamilton have teamed up for almost 900 yards. The Yale defense, Carmine Pirelli from Toronto, Ontario. Tough nose tackle. Lee and Howard, very active at the defensive tackle positions. Skoll and Gaughan. We talked of Chris Gaughan, the captain, at the outside linebacking spot. So then we'll get to the safeties in just a moment. Out of the I formation on third down. Hamilton didn't get the first down. John Furjanic came in from the monster back position to make the stop. Skoll was also there, number 59. Rest of the defense for you. The outside backers are Vickery and McCain. Saw and Drury at the corners. Safeties have played well, Wagner and Furjanic. Fourth down, the snap over the head of the punter, Lutz. A calamitous play, to say the least, for Princeton, and Yale's going to get possession inside the 10-yard line.
Well, you know, we talked about the importance of the kicking game. We talked about the importance of turnovers. There's the first punt attempt. Snap goes over the head of the punter, and Yale gets great, obviously great field position. Not the snap, not even close. It went so far over the head of the punter, Chris Lutz, he had no chance. At this point, you know, trying to pick it up and look up, he gets tatered there. And then he gets a lot of Yale guys come in and get on the football as they take over inside Princeton's 15-yard line.
It was Corbo who made the recovery, and it's first down now for Yale, leading 7-0. Here's a look at it from the end zone view.
Not much Lutz can do right here. You know, even if he falls on, obviously it's going to be Yale's ball, but he should cover the ball so that Yale can advance it and get a chance at a touchdown on the play. Great effort there to get on the ball and try to get upfield.
First down. You get a look at Darin Kehler. Maybe a delay of game penalty coming up here.
A left guard jumped on Yale's offensive line, so they'll mark off the 5 yards.
You're right.
First miscue.
Procedure.
First miscue Yale's had. They came into this ball game very well prepared, given the environmental considerations. Hey, there's Handsome Dan. Handsome Dan, the 13th. That's the Yale mascot. If we could get a look, you see him there.
Come on, Handsome, turn around for us.
Take a look at us here, Handsome. There he is. Handsome Dan the 13th. Looking good.
First and 15 now. Kehler to Callahan.
Yeah, the Callahan was the ball carrier.
Brought down near the line of scrimmage. Leon Newsom got over to make the play.
You know, Darin Kehler is not a big guy. He's very small. Maybe he's listed at 5'10", but I don't think he's more than 5'8", 5'8 and a half. And his hands aren't very big. And talking to him before the ball game about the weather and the rain, he said, you know, when it gets cold and wet, I can't hold the ball in one hand very well to pitch it. So you'll see him sometimes on the option. He'll have to pitch the ball with two hands. Very uncomfortable for an option quarterback.
He's listed at 5'11". Carmcoza said he's never seen 5'11". He's more around 5'10", 5'9 at best. Second down and long. Going over the middle, and it's intercepted by the Tigers. Ken Cisco comes back with it, his second interception of the season, and he's brought down to the vicinity of the 20-yard line. Cisco makes the big play to thwart the Yale drive. Wayne Larrivee, Kevin Guthrie, that's our score. We're at the Yale Bowl.
Watch this play from the end zone. Darin Kehler will drop straight back. He doesn't do a lot of straight drop back. Now, what he does is he's looking to his right, and he doesn't even see the backside linebacker. He's trying to lead his receiver into the middle. He doesn't even see the backside linebacker, Cisco, coming from that other side, his left, to pick off the ball, and Cisco takes it upfield. Obviously, a tremendous break for Princeton because Yale had gotten the big turnover on the punt. Great field position. Princeton gets it back.
First down for Princeton, just across the 20-yard line in Tiger territory. Motion from Michael Lurch. Snap was bobbled for a moment. The outside, that's Hamilton, out near the 30-yard line. Gain of about 8 yards. Scott Wagner responded in the secondary to make the stop along with Eric Drury.
He loses control of the snap at first and just re-grabs it and makes a decent pitch to Hamilton, a little behind him. But the thing that made this play was a block. You see that number 14 for Janet going down. A great block by Hallahan, the fullback on the outside.
Second down, about 2 yards to go at the 29. That's the fullback getting the call. Hallahan up the middle. Took it a bit to the right guard spot. He's close to the first down. Carmine Pirelli in on that stop, along with Eric Lee inside. And they're going to give him a first down as they mark it up across the 30. Take a look at what Yale has contributed to our society. U.S. presidents William Howard Taft, of course, George Bush. More famous grads. Dr. Benjamin Spock. First down now from the 32 for Princeton. Late developing play. Eric Hamilton gets about 9 yards out of it, maybe more, across the 40. Wagner and Saw team up on that tackle. More contributions from this great university. Cole Porter, the composer. Of course, A. Bartlett Giamatti. Jody Foster.
Dude, that's the kind of running that Eric Hamilton has had in his 100 plus games. He gets a first down on first down. He's kind of an upright runner, but he started to run harder and harder as the year's gone on. You saw a good run from him there.
Gain of about 11 on that play. It's first down out across the 42. Hamilton again. Just short of the midfield marker. He'll make it out to the 48-yard line is where they have it spotted down. Kevin Skoll makes the stop on the play.
When I talk about Hamilton running hard, what I mean by that is a lot of the time you'll see a back, when he gets hit, go down right at that yard line. Hamilton had a problem with that early in the season, but as he's progressed through the year, he's done a better job of getting that 2 or 3 extra yards after the first hit. He's running hard now.
Motion from Lurch. Go to the man with the hot hand. Hamilton swinging wide, and John Furjanic makes an outstanding tackle. Furjanic's brother is Tony Furjanic, who was a standout at Notre Dame and later played with the Buffalo Bills.
This is a great defensive play by Yale. Watch, both their linebackers will fill quickly. You see Gone back there, Skull helping also. Both linebackers filling. And then you've got Furjanic, your strong safety, taking on the blocker and setting the outside corner, not letting the back get outside. You got support from your linebackers. You got Furjanic setting the corner. That's the way you beat the sweep.
Loss of five. It is third down and 9 yards to go for Sharp and Company. Screens it out to Hamilton, who can't handle it in the flat.
Joel Sharp dropped back to set up the screen there, set it up pretty well. When he went to turn to throw, he had quite a lot on the ball. I mean, it was only 6 or 7 yards away, and the ball came firing through there. In this kind of weather, it's pretty tough for Hallahan to make that catch.
Chris Lutz on a punt formation. Callahan back deep. Lutz kick caroms out of bounds. Oh, it's going to be a tough day for the kickers at all phases of the game. And from the 26, Yale will take over, leading it by the score of 7-0.
You can make it if you try. You can make it if you try.
We hope you're enjoying the start of this re-air, the 1990 Yale-Princeton football game. So excited to bring this game to Bulldog Nation as we celebrate what would have been the 2020 Yale-Princeton weekend. We have so many special guests to help us tell the tale of this Muddy Classic at Yale Bowl. Let's get our guests started first with the starting tight end from this game, Chris Warner. And Chris, thank you for joining us. How are you?
Doing very well. Thanks very much, Evan. Doing very well. Really, really excited to be watching this and enjoying this game again.
Let's start with a simple question, and I try to ask this to each of our guests. Why Yale?
You know, for me, I went to public high school for 4 years, Nantucket High School, and I ended up taking a postgraduate year at Phillips Exeter Academy, which turned out to be important for me because I realized I was not going to play basketball in college. But I ended up doing well. We had a great team, a great quarterback, and did well in football and started getting recruited for football. And it really came down to between Harvard and Yale. I'm from Massachusetts and live not too far from Harvard. And in the end, I think it came down to the people that I met. You know, I could tell you some stories about my recruiting trip to Yale, not on camera, but you know, it was just a really a good time, I think, with really solid people. And I figure I can go here. And it worked out really well. It worked out for the best.
I think those stories are the best because we all have our moment of seeing campus for the first time and falling in love with Yale. And moving to football, you played for legendary coach Carm Cozza. What was it like playing for Coach?
He was, by the time we were there, which our senior year was 90, he really delegated a lot of his authority, and I think he felt like his responsibility was to the entire team. I got to know him a little bit. We had a senior dinner after the season, which was really enlightening, and I'm really glad he did that. It's something that he did every year, just kind of a no-holds-barred, you know, how do you think this went? And we could, you know, offer critiques, but also you know, look at some of the really good stuff that happened. So I'm very glad that he was my coach. I think it's fair to say that, you know, there was a transition in college football at the time. And I think because he had been coaching for a long time, he was kind of willing to do some of those transitions, but maybe a little more slowly than some other coaches were.
On the field, the Bulldogs were very successful in 1989, going 8-2 with an Ivy League championship. And moving into this 1990 season, you guys had a very, very good offensive football team.
We did. It was the second full year. Our sophomore year, we made the transition because everybody who even thought about playing quarterback for Yale got hurt. So I'm sure you know the story of Darin Kehler getting the phone call in his dorm room to come back. And it was really, I think, one of the more impressive things that Coach Koza and offensive coach Seb Laspina did was to change the entire offense. You know, we were getting recruited as freshmen, or when we came in as freshmen, Kelly Ryan was the starting quarterback, and he was a really just about an NFL caliber quarterback, set all kinds of passing records. Dean Athanasia was a tight end I looked up to a lot, set a lot of records as a receiving tight end, and they threw the ball all over the place. It was a pro style offense. So to make that change after having so much success with it for years, I think was a really impressive decision. And Darin Kehler just knew what to do. He's a scrappy guy who knew you know, when to run, when to keep it. My classmate Kevin Callahan went from being a fullback to being a running back, and as you'll see in this game, really made the most of it. It's just a workhorse. So it was a situation where I think if you looked at any one player, I don't know if we had a ton of talent in our class, but when we all played together, and especially that offensive line, it was a bunch of very smart guys and great technique guys, really knew what they were doing. I think we could play just about anybody.
Moving to this 1990 Princeton game, it was a rainy day at Yale Bowl, and the opening shots from the broadcast show the Rivers coming down the steps, and it seems like we have one of these games every single year.
Yeah, we had a couple. I remember against Lafayette, it was very similar, and we ended up pulling out a win in a game where an extra point kick would have tied it, but we went for two and we got it. And I guess I'll just mention I might have caught it. It's not important. Anyway, the bowl, really, the field took a beating that year. There was a lot of rain, but it was great to wrap up the other way. It was a fun game.
When you think about Yale football, everything builds all season to the last 2 weeks. And how special is it to know the season comes down to two games against your two biggest rivals in back-to-back weeks?
That's such a great thing, isn't it? It really is a wonderful thing about playing football for Yale. That's the way it's been for, you know, as long as I've known it. To have that, you know, the rivalry with Princeton, and then to wrap it up with the most important game of the year, and for a lot of us, the most important game of our lives, you know, the last time we play organized football. So it's just I'm not sure who decided it. Maybe it was a Walter Camp thing. I don't know, but it's just grateful for it. It really brings a lot of meaning to, you know, the final couple of games, no matter what the standings are.
The run game so important in this one, and the offense was so dynamic. And a veteran unit able to get a 34-7 win in this game over the Tigers.
Yeah, I think that's as long as the defense kept it close, we knew we always had a chance. You know, if we had time, then we knew that we could do it. And it's a matter of what the offensive line could do and what Darin could do. You know, I mean, my blocking assignments, I think I had maybe three assignments. It's just either, you know, you let the defensive end go, or if it's a sweep, you block him, or sometimes every once in a while you release and try to get to a linebacker. But it was just, you know, when a wishbone, even to this day, I like to watch Navy football and other college teams who run it. When it's run well, it's really a impressive thing to watch, and I think we ran it really well.
You all did run it very well, and with wins over Princeton and then the next week against Harvard for an HYP championship. Chris, thank you for your time and your insight into this big win for the Bulldogs.
Thank you so much, Evan. I appreciate it.
That was Chris Warner, starting tight end for the 1990 Yale Bulldogs. Don't go anywhere. More guests and more football as Yale and Princeton rolls on.
Hit as he throws, and the pass falls harmlessly incomplete. Intended for Dan Bentz. Greg Vickery in hard on the quarterback. Fourth down for Princeton. Chris Lutz on. Callahan back deep. Appears to have the wind to his back. Callahan makes a couple of good moves and then is driven back on the play.
Punt was returned by Callahan.
Wilson forced him down.
Rain is starting to pick up again, and the wind is starting to blow harder, and it's blowing in Yale's face right now in the first quarter. They got rain on, and wind D. coming in their face right now.
Go, Jeff, baby. Go, baby.
The officials try to keep the ball dry. 7-0. First period of play. 1:12 left to go in the first quarter. Wayne Larrabee, Kevin Guthrie, we're at the Yale Bowl. First down, the 26-yard line. Gouveia. Off the left side, out to about the 30-yard line. Aaron Harris, inside linebacker, made the stop.
Coach Craig Kasin, the offensive line coach, working with his interior line, trying to figure out what adjustments they need to make to get their offense going here. They haven't moved the ball real well so far in the first quarter. Yale doing a good job defensively.
Second down situation coming up for Kehler and company. Football just short of the 30-yard line of Yale. Callahan straight ahead for almost 4, maybe 5 yards. That portion of the defense rose to the occasion. Ranging up from the secondary to make the stop, Gene DeMorat. It's a third down. Yale, hard to tell on the wind, it's swirling. But time is winding down to this first period of play. Yale at the moment going into the wind, and I think what they want to do is wind the clock as long as they can. See if they can get the wind to their back, and they're going to wait till they switch sides. And when Yale faces their 3rd and 2 to begin the second period of play, they'll have the wind to their back. Kehler comes over to the sidelines to chat with Carm Koza and company. That's the end of the first period of play. We'll be back.
Today's show is action-packed on the field and with all of our special guests that we have along for the ride. And we stay on the offense to talk to starting guard and member of the Toads, Rob Michalik. Rob, thank you for joining us. And this game is just so much fun to watch.
Fantastic. I'm so happy that you found this and shared it with me. It made my Thursday night watching this and bringing back just a lot of great memories about Yale football and our team and our senior year.
You and your twin brother were both starters on the offensive line in this game. So my first question is, why Yale? What drew you both to New Haven?
You know, it's a funny but short story. My brother and I grew up in Detroit. Our dad was a fireman. And thank God, we wanted to play for the University of Michigan. That was our dream growing up. And we were too slow to be linebackers and too small to be linemen. But thank God we were great students. And Coach Dave Kelly found us. We had talked to a few other Ivies, Penn, Princeton, Cornell, and, of course, Columbia, who I think would take anybody who would show up. But we just had a great feeling about Yale. We had visited Harvard one summer on a family vacation and walked through the Harvard Square, and they're excavating the Harvard yard, and my brother turned to me and said, "This place is weird. I'd never go to school here." And so we didn't even talk to the guys up north. And when we got into to Yale, we were absolutely thrilled. It was a dream come true to have the opportunity to play at Yale for Carm Koza. You know, one of the greatest traditions in college football. And I think the most important part, you know, Coach Koza mentioned it in his lead-in with the ESPN interview. It's just great people. And you're at a university with some of the best people in the world. And, you know, that makes the whole experience that much better.
When you look at this 1990 season, you all had a very good year in 1989, winning Coach Koza his last Ivy League championship. And in 1990, the offense led the team to the success that you guys were able to find.
In 89, we had nine senior starters on the defensive side of the ball. Everyone knew our defense was going to be extraordinary. And the offense was the big surprise. And we went to the wishbone in 89. They moved a bunch of smaller, quicker guys like my brother and I to the offensive line. And we developed this wishbone and we shocked the league. No one was prepared for it. No one could defend it. And we were able to couple a surprise offense with an extraordinary defense. Our senior year, complete turnaround, right? And now we had the vaunted wishbone offense. We had seven seniors returning starters on the offensive side of the ball, including Darin Kehler, who was just unstoppable. And our defensive side of the ball had two returning starters, Chris Gaughan, our captain, and Craig Vickery, our outside linebacker, and nine first-time starters, including a bunch of sophomores. And it was it was just a tough season. Our defensive line was learning, great young guys, talented guys, but just didn't have the experience. And, you know, we ended up, playing well, but losing some tough games, three of which when Darin Kehler was out and hurt. Fortunately, those were two non-leagues, and then Dartmouth, which was a big disappointment. We certainly could have taken Dartmouth with Darin on the field. And then we had a shootout with Cornell in the Yale Bowl. And I forget the final score, but it was something along the lines of 43-41. It was just a matter of who had the ball last. And, and for a senior offense that, seemed to score pretty much at will, it was tough to have to, watch the defense against, again, very strong Cornell team. But, it was a tough season for our defense that year. Chris Gaughan was hurt quite a bit. And, those things add up over time.
They say you can judge a Yale team from what they do in the last two games of the year. And that quest started in this game against Princeton. Rainy day at the Yale Bowl, a great environment. What did you recognize from going back and watching the tape?
The funny thing about our senior year is that we had three games that were absolute rainouts. I forget if it was Lehigh or Lafayette, but there was a hurricane that sort of blew through the bowl that morning. And so this was sort of standard practice for our senior year, was playing in these wet, mucky conditions. We had a lot of fun with it. Guys diving through the mud puddles at the end of the games, and it was almost a source of pride. But yeah, this one was, the rain didn't let up the entire game. And, fortunately for us, our offense and our approach to the game allowed us to, run 90% of the time. And then when we did throw the ball, the receivers were pretty wide open most of the time. So the wet conditions actually played to our benefit in many ways, and particularly on the defensive side, where, like I said, we were quite young. And, when we came against teams that like Cornell, when actually it didn't rain and they had a great quarterback throwing the ball and they were able to run up yardage on our defense when the conditions were more stable, our defense actually benefited from slowing down the other side. So it was our environment. That mud bowl was designed for us.
You come into Yale with a group of guys and 4 years later, you step on the field together for the last time. So let's talk about the folks you played with, the class of 1991 guys that you came into Yale with.
So, we had a really good class. Ironically, we were the first freshman class to not have a winning record. The seniors of 90, the seniors of 89, the seniors of 88, all those guys came in as freshman teams at Yale and pretty much went undefeated. We were 3-3. People were looking at our class and going, my goodness, this is a ragtag group of guys. but where there was a lot of character in our team and a lot of, real hustle and dedication, smaller guys who played hard. Quite frankly, it wound up being a group of guys that just loved, being there and being together, and that made a big difference. And of course, when we got, Darin Kehler did play our freshman year. He chose not to play football as a sophomore after a couple of injuries. Carmcoza had to convince him to come back and play because we were desperate in need of a quarterback. And Darin just made a big difference to our success as a team and as a class. I attribute it more to our coaching staff, though, and their genius of putting this wishbone in place for 20 years. Carmcoza ran a power eye drop back pass, and all of a sudden we're running the triple option a la Navy or Air Force or Army, and it was a great decision. The guys, like I said, we stayed close till today. A lot of time with Chris Gaughan and John Neary and Bob Baddick and Kevin Callahan, Chris Warner. I see these guys a lot to this day, and they're my my best friends. It's been a wonderful experience.
A lot of folks got into this game as the lead built in the second half, and I heard a rumor about one of the headshot photos that was used in the broadcast.
Yeah, so my roommate, senior Bob Baddick, was the leader of the defensive line that year. As I mentioned, a lot of young guys in that group, but Bob didn't play much. He was the inspiration. That Bob Baddick, they called him the Batman, and they used to do a bat symbol to the sideline when they had a sack. And in this game, when they introduced Fred Howard, who was a sophomore starting lineman, Fred let Bob stand in as his face for the interviews and for the photos. And so every time they mention Fred Howard and flash his picture, that's actually Bob Baddick. It was relatively entertaining. I forgot all about it till I rewatched the game last night, and I was just laughing because, they pulled this little stunt.
That was Rob Michalik, Yale class of 1991 and a senior offensive lineman in this 1990 Princeton game. Why wait? Let's welcome in another guest. This time it's another senior on the 90 team, John Neary. And John, it's great to have you with us. And let's start with the most important question. Why Yale?
Yale was just an amazing combination of academic rigor and athletics. Personally, for me, the athletics part was going to be a stretch playing, Division I AA at the time. But really the combination of those two. And then frankly, on my recruiting trip, I just met great human beings engaged in life and happy to share their journey with me as a young high school recruit. So it was immediate and obvious choice.
You played for Carmcoza. What made him such a great head coach?
He was just a good man. And the fact that he remembered my name, I know one of my early jobs I got coming out of school, I needed a recommendation. And he personally hand wrote a letter with detail on it. I didn't know he knew who I was, but he did. He was a good man. He cared for his players and really left an amazing personal mark on the program.
Coming off an Ivy championship in 1989, you all didn't have the same success in 1990, but you were able to get wins in the last two games of the year.
It was fun. The HYP meant a great deal to us. Our class, was a smaller class, but we were feisty. We competed, and it was an honor to go out winning those last two games at home and then and up north as well.
Looking at this game, a lot of wet, a lot of mud, and a lot of muck and mire in this game against the Tigers.
Yeah, I mean, you would not, these conditions, it was not fit for human habitation. The Yale Bowl was empty. It was only true diehards and families there. There might have been less than 1,000 people at the game, but of course it was broadcast on national TV at a time when there was one ESPN. So if you were anywhere across America wanted to watch college football, you were watching the Yale Bowl, and there was nobody there because of the conditions, but it was a fun game.
A victory for the Bulldogs over the Tigers. John, thank you for your time and your thoughts on this game from your senior year.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. Good luck.
That was John Neary, Yale class of 1991, and the fun is just getting started. More of Yale and Princeton continues now.
Mike Davis, the injured player, he's the right guard.
He struggled with a sore ankle all season. He's missed a couple games with a bad ankle. First team All-Ivy a year ago, supposed to be the leader of this offensive line coming into this year, has had a lot of injuries, has had trouble leading it.
See if we can pick it up here, Kevin.
You see number 58. He'll stand up in late. Looks like Bentz is trying to get in there to get on the football and just hits him from the side. He just got hit right from the side. He looks like he's okay as he comes off on his own power.
They mark it as a loss of one. Second down and 11 coming up at the 45-yard line of Yale. Sharp back to throw. Got his man Bentz in the flat. Good move by Bentz to pick up the first down inside the 35 near the 32. Scott Wagner got over to make the play defensively. 13-yard gain, Dan Bentz. Senior out of Osceola, Wisconsin, second leading rusher on the team, and looks like Chris Gaughan, number 40, is shaken up for Yale.
He doesn't want to go out. Jerry Joyce is going to come in. Gaughan is going to have to go out. As you said, he's got a shoulder and neck problem, a nerve problem, and he gets hit there, and he's going to come off the field.
A penalty marker late in that play, clipping the call against Princeton, so that wipes out the gain and the first down. It makes it second down and long.
Big penalty there, obviously, for Princeton, but a tough loss for Yale. Watch it right late there. Mark Rogers, number 81, just a little push at the end of the play, and that's what got the flag, the clipping on the call.
Sharp. Trying to swing it out to Bentz. That ball was tipped, it appeared, by Fred Howard. And it's third down coming up.
You know, Coach Kozis speaks nothing but the highest praise of Chris Gaughan, who just came off the field in the last play. He said, if this guy's healthy, there's no better linebacker than him in the Ivy League. Gaughan is a tough player. He doesn't want to go off the field. I talked to him yesterday. He's a real interesting kid. He works for the Chicago Board of Trade on the Futures Exchange. He's taken Japanese for four semesters, speaks some Japanese now. He'd really like to make that Ivy Bowl where the Ivy League All-Stars go to Japan. What a great emissary he would be speaking Japanese over in the land of the rising sun.
They're down at 18, and they reverse it to Michael Lurch, who slips and falls back inside the 45-yard line. Fred Howard got out in front of that play defensively and forced it wide, and eventually forced its conclusion at the 43-yard line.
Little razzle-dazzle trying to run the reverse. Now, one of the things that Lurch is real good at is changing direction, but on a field like this, you can't do it. And you see number 28, Michael Lurch, go down. Big penalty late as you look at Fred Howard there on your screen. The big penalty on the clipping took away a first down. Then Princeton had a long yardage situation, had to try to throw a pass and run a reverse, lost even more yardage. Now in the battle of field position, they lost about 30 yards in the exchange there.
Chris Lux is fifth in the Ivy League in punting. Tough day for the kickers. Penalty marker down. Lutz was run into on the play. And the ball covered downfield on the far side where Yale will take over. Inside the 20, Princeton claims they got the ball. I see no indication yet from the officials. See if we can pick it up. Right now the officials are trying to sort it out.
Watch the ball as it comes downfield. See, now Princeton thinks that the ball hit Maurice Saw, number 10 right there. They jump on the ball thinking they've got a fumble. Callahan tries to help. Now he doesn't touch it yet either. The question is, did the ball hit Saw on the leg? Because Kevin Callahan definitely did not touch the ball. Even though he made a move for it, he did not touch the ball. Princeton celebrating on that side of the field. They believe that they're getting the ball. I think the officials have ruled that either Saw or Callahan touched the ball, and Princeton gets a fumble recovery.
Roughing the kicker penalty is turned down.
Watch Maurice Saw, number 10. The ball's very close to hitting him there. It's hard to, you know, you can't tell.
Yeah, it might have. It looked like it changed direction. It might have hit him in the shin. And the officials took their time in making the call to make sure they had the right call and have given it to Princeton. Football near the 17-yard line of Yale. So Princeton gets a break. They're trailing 7-0. We have 5:23 to go, first half of play in a driving rainstorm.
Okay.
Hamilton. Down to about the 12-yard line, and we head back to that warm, comfortable studio, Jim Brando.
The Big Ten battle of the day. Ohio State and Iowa. Greg Fry of the Buckeyes will go back. Look for Jeff Graham. Merton Hanks should have it, right? Wrong. On the deflection, it's a touchdown. Took Jeff Graham 17-14 at the half, and now they're whistling the Buckeye battle cry on High Street in Columbus, Wayne.
Second down right here, out of the eye. Snap is fumbled by Sharp. He picks it up on both knees, and when your knee is down in college football, the play is over. May have lost about a yard of the play. I tell you what, I think the youngsters persevere a lot better than we adults, and they're chasing down an umbrella.
Now they're gonna have trouble pulling it out of there. Great day for football.
You say that with a little twinge to your voice there. Third down. Penalty markers down. Sharp going to the air. Got his man inside the 5-yard line near the two. Again, a penalty marker is down to the play.
You're going to see a holding call. Great catch by Lurch on the outside near the end zone, number 28. Flag thrown in the offensive backfield. Lurch struggles back to the huddle.
Left part of the screen. Watch it. See if we can pick it up.
He's got the flag out there early. He saw holding right off the bat and threw the flag right away.
Eric Lee was the man who was held, at least in from what we could tell on that picture. It looked like that's where the ball was. Apparently, though, they've called an illegal motion penalty. It's a 5-yard penalty, not holding. Illegal motion the call. Third down, about 11. Sharp. Over the top to the end zone. Diving grab made on the far sidelines, and they're going to mark it as a first and goal. Rodgers on the catch. At the one.
Watch number 81, Mark Rodgers. He's going to run a corner route. Very tough route to run in this footing. He'll start toward the middle of the field, look inside, and then head for the corner. You see he had to settle down. Now he sees the ball and adjusts well, makes an excellent catch on the outside. Now, Mark Rodgers had some trouble this year, not catching balls, but that's a big catch down there near the end zone.
The officials hold up the action for a moment. I'll tell you something, that's not a bad pass in these kinds of conditions. You talk about not only the rain, but Joel Sharp, number two, was throwing into the wind.
That's a great point, Wayne, because not only is he throwing into the wind, but the thing he did nicely about that throw, not bad coverage, he threw it in an area where only Rodgers could get to the football. No way the defensive back could make a play. Rodgers makes a great catch on the outside. Maurice Saw was the cornerback on the coverage. And the ball's wobbling a little bit in the wind, but it's out there where nobody can get it but Rodgers. Saw trying to come up on the outside. Nice catch again by number 81.
Mark Rodgers came in with 16 receptions. Touchdown! Chris Hallahan!
Big story in that drive, obviously the big turnover. Yale's getting ready to take the football over on a punt. The ball bounces off one of their players. Princeton recovers in their territory. Great catch by Rodgers and inside to Hallahan for the score.
Chris Lutz now. Oh, the point after. He's 14 of 15, this to tie the game. And the kick is good.
Score, Yale 7.
3 minutes and 28 seconds left to go in this first half. Princeton has caught Yale.
Watch it from the sideline. You'll see the fake pitch and then just inside to Hallahan, and he'll just jump over the top into the end zone for the score. Pretty good job there on the offensive line. He'll come right into your homes now on the screen, right over the top. You see what Princeton did is they got down underneath Yale, got them down on the ground so they couldn't stay up, and Hallahan just jumps over the top.
Four plays, 17 yards. I think Chris Hallahan's having a pretty good time. I don't know what you're worried about.
Great story for Hallahan in the sense that he was a blocking back even in high school. Not really very widely recruited out of Hackensack, New Jersey. Came up, was a role player here at Princeton, has just fought his way up to the starting lineup. He's been a two-year starter for him. Has done a great job. His primary role is to block, but he got the inside handoff there.
The point I'm making, of course, with you rather kiddingly, Kevin, is that as a skill position player, wide receiver, you don't like to see a track like this. It affects the way you make your cuts. Short drive of just 17 yards off the recovery of the loose ball on the Princeton punt by the Tigers, and they cash in. Saw on the far side of your screen.
Come on, Mel. Callahan
on the near side, and here's the kickoff. Callahan makes the play across the 20. And he's down near the 25-yard line. Excellent play made by Mike DiMarino. Mike DiMarino on the stop, first down.
I think it was number 28,
yeah,
Mike
Lurch. Was Mike Lurch, yes.
Yeah, it was Mike Lurch, which is a great play. You know, he's an offensive player, hustles down there, makes a good play on special teams, and keeps Yale back in their own end at 25 yards.
Gotta keep it going, gotta.
First down, Darin Kehler. Kehler looking to the air. He's got his man, Shabazz, inside Princeton territory near the 43-yard line. Tom Bevan made the stop.
Tremendous play action fake there. That's what made that play. As Flo goes to the right side, everyone on Princeton's defense thinks this is a run. Now watch, Darin pulls the ball up right now and sees Shabazz down the field wide open. Now on another day, that's going to be a touchdown. It's tough to throw and catch in this weather. Shabazz makes the nice catch and a good tackle across there downfield. But the play action is what made that play.
32-yard pass play. First down inside the 45 of Princeton. Kehler to Gavea. He's brought down back near the 45. Excellent coverage provided by Tom Bevan.
As you watch that play, you see how the weather really affects Darin Kehler. The thing that he does really well is he makes nice little fakes and late pitches. He cannot do that in this kind of weather. You saw in that time, moving toward his left, he pitched it with both hands. He told me yesterday that in a wet weather day like this, he has to pitch with two hands, but he feels even less comfortable going to his left.
Second and 12, loss of two on that play. They break the bone into an eye. On a delay, Callahan. Down to about the 37-yard line of Princeton, where it'll be third down. Coming up, the premiere on ESPN of NFL football, the 49ers of the Cowboys. Join us at 8 p.m. Eastern time. NFL football returns to ESPN. Mike Patrick and Joe Theismann will have it all for you. Third down for Yale. It's about 5 yards to go. Gain of 7 of the previous play. Kehler keeps it himself, and he's not close to the first down. He got barely a yard. Charity and Dave Wright team up on the tackle that time for Princeton. And it's fourth down.
Fourth down, interesting choice here. Just a minute and 23 left in the half. Decent field position. Yale's going to go for it, I think. Fourth down and 4. As they send the skill guy Shabazz back in to split end.
Time winding down on the play clock. Kehler screens it out. Corey trying to get his footing. Not enough for the first down.
Mike Carew is the man who made that play. He didn't get in on the final tackle, but he reacted very quickly to the screen. Watch number 22. We're going to ISO on him. You see him. He settles back. He sees pass. Now he reads screen. He's going to come up very fast. He gets beyond the lineman, makes Corey turn to the inside. That takes away the play. Then he gets help from number 24, Marvin Williams, to make the tackle.
First down now for the Princeton Tigers. We're tied at 7 apiece in the final 2 minutes of play in this first half. Sharp on the give to the fullback, Hallahan. Hallahan may have gotten a yard. Lee in on that stop, along with Chris Vickery. Make that Craig Vickery. Coming up at halftime, scores and highlights with Tim Brando and Lee Corso. And we'll have a discussion also on who's going to be number one, who should be number one at this stage. We'll kick it around for you. Second down. Tough run again for Hallahan on the carry. Got about 3, maybe 4 yards out of that. Time winding down to this first half. That should be it. So in a driving rainstorm, these two teams have battled to a standoff after the first 30 minutes of play. It's Princeton 7, Yale 7. Halftime with Tim and Lee is coming up next.
We hope you are enjoying our re-air of Yale and Princeton from 1990. We'll look to the defense now for our next special guest. It is Monster Back John Furjanic. And Furj, how are you? And thank you for joining us.
I'm doing great, and thanks so much for asking me.
Looking back at your football career, why Yale? Why did you want to play football here in New Haven?
Well, I wanted to go to the best school possible and play football, and there was no school that was better, and fortunately Yale gave me the opportunity to play. So, there were many schools in the Midwest that I looked at, but when I went out to my recruiting visit and met some of the gang, such as Kevin Bryce from St. Lawrence, and some of the other fellows, I just fell in love with the place.
You played for Carm Koza, so I have to ask, do you have a Carm story that really stands out?
Well, to me, Carm was just so consistent. He was always out there early on the practice field. And I remember looking up and seeing him, seeing him up in the press box. And then the next time I'd look up, I'd see him out on the field patrolling. And I knew that he knew everything that was going on the field. So for me, it was really just that consistency of being there, all the time and aware of what was going on.
Taking a look back at the 1990 season, not the success that you all had in the year before in 89, but you did win the two most important games of the year.
We did. And I think, those two games come at the end of the season, as we know. And I just felt, we knew that we were, a strong team, stronger than our record portrayed. And we wanted to go out on a high note. So, it was great to go out with victories in the last two games of the season.
In this Princeton game, we were talking before we went on air, and you mentioned Darin Kehler and the incredible offensive attack that you guys had here in 90 and how the Bulldogs were able to adapt the offense to find success.
I felt that I played an integral part in our success because my sophomore year, I was a quarterback, and I was injured in my very first play against University of Connecticut. I played the rest of that game, but then on the way down to play Navy, my ankle ballooned up and I couldn't play. And so that gave Carm the opportunity to go to the bullpen and call in the right-hander Darin Kehler. And so I felt that me getting injured really was a big part of our team's success.
Everyone that we have talked to has brought up the rain, and that seemed to be a theme of this 1990 season. It was a muddy mess at the bowl against the Tigers.
It was, and I felt that it favored our defense. I remember a couple of plays in particular. Coach Brown had us coached up to against the power sweep of Princeton, and we read our keys. I read my keys and was able to, initiate contact in the backfield on a couple of plays, which I think neutralized some of their, you know, power sweep game. So I felt it was great from a defensive standpoint. And despite the fact that we ran the, you know, the bone, or, you know, Darin was able to control the ball, and, you know, Callahan was able to, you know, take care of the ball and really, you know, go north and south. So I felt that was a big advantage for us.
Well, you're talking about this Yale program, and I've experienced it myself. We're a family, and Coach Reno talks a lot about it being a 40-year decision, not a 4-year decision. How has the Yale football family affected your life and career since football has been over?
Well, I have some very, very tight personal relationships with, you know, with my Yale fellow Yale folks. I can say that I got my my very second job out of school as a result of my relationship with Tom Morrell, who is you know, a linebacker for us in who graduated a year before me. His father introduced me to a bank here in Chicago. And now I continue to have strong personal relationships. And I was just on the call today with Zinger and Chris Gaughan, et cetera. So, you know, it is a big part of my life. And as I get older, I really cherish those friendships and the memories that we had together.
That was John Furjanic, the monster back for the 1990 Yale football team. Yale Princeton continues, and we have a lot more guests to come.
Out of the play, forced the pitch, got good support on the outside, and then it just comes down to the spot. As you see, Princeton comes up short. So it'll be fourth and short, and I think Coach Tosh is going to have to go with a punt here, maintain the field position in this game for the wind and the rain.
That's what he does.
Take out a Yale ball.
Chris Lutz comes on. You got to look at the amount of distance to go for the first down. It's fourth down.
Well, this early in the third quarter, and you've got basically the wind in your face, you want to try to force Yale back into their own territory as much as possible, so they'll try to kick it away.
Chris Lutz is the punter, and there is Callahan. Lutz, number 8. Callahan is back deep on fourth down and less than a yard. This snap is right on the money. Lutz gets off a line drive kick that squibs across the 30. Callahan backs off on it, and the ball comes to a stop near the 27-yard line, where the Eli will take over. First down. We've got a break. We'll be back. Wayne Larrivee, Kevin Guthrie in the mud of the Yale Bowl. I don't know, Kevin, I used to enjoy playing in games like this in the backyard, you know, the Turkey Bowl type games we used to play, touch football in the mud like this. I would think the kids would get a big kick out of this. As you mentioned, though, the wide receivers looking for those catches, trying to make those cuts, it could be a tough day. First down for Yale. Kehler breaks through. Near the 40-yard line, Trevor Crossan, free safety, got over to make the stop for Princeton.
Yale's first offensive play of the second half looks almost exactly like the offensive play that started the ball game. Kehler going on the lead option, gets a little room on the outside, and then takes it right up the field. Great block there by Corey. Watch Trevor Crossan, number 16, come in with his head late. Might have gotten a personal foul penalty there. That was definitely a late hit, and he led with his head as well.
From the wishbone on first down of the 40. Govea goes down hard in the middle of the line. They've gotten about a yard out of that. Leon Newsom made a great stick on the play.
Yeah, a little pancake there. Watch Newsom as he comes up from the right side down at the bottom of your screen, number 90. He'll catch Govea as he's trying to make a cut and just take him right off his feet. Good hit by Newsom inside.
Leon Newsom and Charity on the other side, our great bookend defensive ends. Renard Charity also very active. Then you get a look at Newsom, number 90. Second down and 8. They'll break the bone into the eye. Callahan to the 46-yard line, where it'll be third down and a little bit less than 5 yards to go coming up. Gene DeMorant, linebacker, got over to make the stop for Princeton.
One of the amazing things about Yale is a tradition of NFL players they've been able to put out. They haven't just gotten guys to come up there and play in the NFL. Carmcoza has developed players that have turned into all pros. Rich Diana is one, but Gary Fensick, Calvin Hill, Kenny Hill, Jeff Rohr, John Spagnuolo, they've just got a great tradition of NFL players here at Yale.
Third down now, and about 4 yards to go. Out of the bone. Kehler. Knocked away, broken up nicely, intended for Gavea. Marvin Williams made the play down the sidelines.
Well, we saw a big play down the field early off play action and a deep pass. Darin Kehler tried to go to it there. Gavea pretty well covered by Marvin Williams. Williams came out for the first time for football this year. Started out as a basketball player for Princeton. As a guard, wasn't getting much playing time. A great athlete, high jumps over 7 feet. Nice play there.
Bowman on in punt formation. Wade Wilson, tough to make a juke move on this kind of a track. He's out to about the 21-yard line. Corralled right there. Jason Turner led the way. Kevin Hill was also there on the coverage for Yale. Carmcoza's been here at New Haven as head coach at Yale for 25 now and 26 years. He talked about why he's been here so long.
Yale is a great institution for a lot of reasons. Number one, academically, they're probably second to none. The quality of young men that you have the good fortune of working with here, they all get after the academics as well as the football. The thing, the greatest record I have going for me in all the years I've been here, I believe we've only had 6 not get degrees in the 26 years that I've been here as a head coach. So. You know, for a lot of these reasons, it's a great place to coach. They're real quality people, and I think the philosophy of the league is the right philosophy, in that, you know, these players are not given any special privileges. They really have to do everything every other student does on this campus.
Second down at about 9. Sharp to the air, the pass wide of the mark intended for Tarkenton. Furjanic had the coverage on the near side. Well, you know, Carmcoza, as I mentioned, has been here so long, he's had many opportunities, no doubt, to move on because he is a great coach and tremendous teacher. You know, you and I talked to him yesterday, Kevin, and you came away from the conversation saying, I think he really loves to teach more than anything else. He sat with us in the film room watching some tape of his football team, explaining to us the intricacies of his wishbone offense.
He did. I felt like I was one of his players. He just sat us down there and took us through what they were doing offensively. He's just a great teacher, and you can tell he really enjoys it.
Third down. Hamilton going wide. Penalty marker is down, and Hamilton got out to maybe the 25, a gain of 2 yards. Eric Drury, the defensive back, came up to force the run.
And there's a flag
on the call against Princeton. As I mentioned, there was a flag down early in that play.
On a third down play, obviously, Chris Gaughan, the captain's going to decline that one. Carmcoza is going to decline that one and get the football back, force Princeton to punt. You know, Coach Coza was talking about players having to do everything that other students do. And, you know, in the Ivy League, what ends up happening is sometimes you'll have classes that are late or a lab that goes to 4:30, and it's a real struggle because you have to try to leave the lab early, which your professor doesn't like. You get to practice late, which your coach doesn't like. And it puts a player in a tough position.
Chris Lutz did a good job to get that punt off, and it dies. I mean, literally dies on the 46-yard line. So Yale gets good field position from their own of 46 to start their next drive in a 7-7 battle.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
Wayne Larrabee, Kevin Guthrie. The quagmire that is the Yale Bowl this afternoon. Princeton and Yale tied at 7 apiece. The Bulldogs get the football at their 46-yard line in this third period of play. 10-13, the quarterback has broken into the top 10 rushing list here at Yale. 53 yards on the ground today. Corey, his fullback, off left guard, picks up about 3, maybe 4 yards out close to the first down. Out close, I should say, to the midfield marker. BYU and Wyoming coming up at 4 o'clock today. And then our primetime game, Houston at Texas. We'll get a look at number three, Houston, against a very good Texas squad in a key Southwest Conference game. Second down coming up. Bulldogs near the midfield marker. Callahan. Close to the 46-yard line. He's about 2, maybe 3 yards short of that first down. Ken Sisko got the tackle for Princeton, and we're looking at a third down for Yale.
Third and short. You know, typically on a nice day, Yale would like to go to the option here, let Kehler go down the line, find a spot, or pitch the ball. On a day like today, it's a tough call to make, but I still think Carmcoza will want to go to the option here.
They break the bone now into a power eye formation. Third down call. Callahan rumbles through for a first down to the Princeton 40. Mike Carew is in on the tackle along with Tom Bevan, a couple of defensive backs. And it is first down for the Bulldogs of Yale. Moving the football steady here on this drive. It began on the 46 of Yale. Yale took the opening drive of the ball game and scored. Princeton came back and on a break had a 17-yard drive to their score in the second period of play. Gavea trying to reach forward down to the 35 on a gain of about 6 yards.
So if you see the back of the helmet of the offensive lineman, you see those little blue circles, those are toads. The offensive line has about a 20-year tradition here of calling themselves the Toads. And on a day like today, you got to think it's perfect. In under the mud and the wind and the rain, the Toads are playing well. They went behind the Toads a couple times straight at Princeton and have gotten 5 yards in the last two plays.
Second down at about 5. Corey, the fullback, breaks one tackle and picks up the first down. Inside the 30 to the 28-yard line of Princeton. Good power by the fullback. Sisko, the linebacker, got over to help out on the tackle.
Those decals are awards. And basically, when they watch films, you take a shot at Chris Corey on a good run there. They watch films, and if a lineman gets a pancake or makes a great block or grades out very well, he'll get a toad for the back of his helmet. Then the linemen will get together, and they'll vote for honorary toads. Like, say, on that run, Chris Corey running over a defensive player for Princeton, he might get an honorary toad on the back of his helmet for that play.
Coach Koza said, I don't like them. They mess up the helmets. Wishbone formation on first down. Kehler looking to the air. Touchdown! Yassine Shabazz!
Great series there for Yale. Again, the thing that's worked for them in the passing game, not surprisingly, is the play-action pass. Darin Kehler fakes down the line of scrimmage. It looks like run. Now, Yassine Shabazz is lined up on the far right of the field. Now, the offensive line, Michalik, there, number 65, doing a good job, but it's a throwback. Shabazz, number 11, coming across the middle on a post, just beat Marvin Williams in what looked like single coverage for the score.
First score for Yale since the opening drive of the ball game. Ed Perks. Puts the extra point through the uprights. And with 7:16 left to go in the third, Eli on a touchdown lead.
We hope you're enjoying the re-air of the 1990 Yale-Princeton football game. For our next guest, we stay with the defense and talk to linebacker Jerry Joyce. And Jerry, my first question is simple. Why Yale?
Yale, because I had a family friend and somebody I looked up to in my neighborhood that had gone to Yale 5 years before me and played football there. His name was Ardell McKenna. And once I found out he was going there, I sort of always kind of was hoping that maybe I could follow that same path. Unfortunately, it worked out.
When you think about defense in the Carm Cosa era, it was always tenacious defenses for Coach Cosa and the staff. What made playing for this staff so special?
Well, Coach Cosa had brought in Don Brown, and he had Dave Kelly work with him, and he pretty much gave them free rein, and their idea of defense was very aggressive. So it was a fun time to be playing linebacker under Coach, not only Coach Cosa, but Coach Brown and Coach Kelly.
In 1989, you all won the Ivy League, but you weren't able to get the Big Three championship, which was something you all were able to get done in 1990.
We won the Ivy League in 89. In 90, we came up short going into the last two games, Princeton and Harvard. We could control our destiny with that. We needed a little help from the rest of the league to win the conference again. Unfortunately, that didn't happen, but we were able to beat Princeton and Harvard to win the HYPs, which is the second best thing to win in the Ivy League. Going into that Princeton game was for us seniors, was pretty intense because it was the last time we were going to be together at home on coming out of the Yale Bowl. It was our last home game, and it started to sink in there at pretty much this career that we had for 4 years and 10 and 14 or 15 years, many of us playing football, and was coming to an end all too quickly as the clock wound down. So that was a pretty emotional game, Princeton and obviously Harvard away was, but the last home game coming to the bowl with those guys that we had started 4 years before and went through a lot together and hung in there, and it was a special time.
That was Jerry Joyce, Yale linebacker and member of the class of 1991. We already have another guest ready to go, and this time we'll move back to the offense, and it's Rich Toryikian, a tight end and junior at the time of this 1990 Yale-Princeton game. Rich, how are you?
I'm well. Well, given despite what's going on with COVID in the world, we're very blessed and lucky considering what other people are going through.
Rich, we're looking back at this 1990 Princeton game today, but my first question for you is, why Yale?
You know, it's kind of like what I've been telling my kids who are also athletes, and funny enough, just had Adam Linane, who was a receiver on the team, over to our home the other night, and it was a gut sense. It's the history. It's the people I met on the recruiting trip. It was the grounds. It's the bowl. It's the coaches. It was really a culmination of a lot of things. I had actually verbally committed to Penn and told the Penn coaches I only have one more trip to take, and took my trip to Yale and had to rescind my commitment given just how overwhelming the trip that I had at the end of the recruiting process.
You play for Coach Cosa and his staff. What was it like playing for Carm?
The thing that was amazing to me is how much he empowered his assistant coaches. That's the thing I really walked away with. I was so used to having been an athlete in multiple sports in high school, and I also played lacrosse at Yale as well, where the head coach was so involved at the most granular level with every single thing. And the confidence that he instilled in his position coaches and relegated a lot of the, I call it day-to-day work to them and really empowered them with decision-making. So that was really interesting to me, especially as I extrapolate that out, you know, afterwards in my career.
Looking at this game, you all were able to get something done that eluded the 1989 team, and that was winning the HYP championship.
Yes, it was, I tell you, that was obviously phenomenal, but there are a lot of big shoes to fill coming out of the 89 season. There were a lot of very unique characters, whether that was our leadership with John Reese, whether it was the rest of the senior class. They were just an incredible group of guys, and, you know, it was next man up. Obviously, there were a lot of guys on the 91 team that had big roles in that championship team, but it was really terrific to be able to run the tables and do that with the HYP that year in terms of, again, just that mentality and next man up. We also had a lot of really good sophomores that stepped up as well in that class.
You talk about that next man up attitude, and that was a mentality that went beyond the guys playing on Saturday to the guys playing hard every day in practice.
Yeah, absolutely. Just in the sport of football generally, and specifically to Yale, nobody ever talks about the guys on the scout team. They got to come in day in and day out. They don't get a blow. They got to hit the weights. They got to run. They get their head pounded every single day. And at the end of the day, you need those guys. And I just have so much respect for the guys on the scout team, especially the guys who are lifetimers. We had a lot of guys in every class who are lifetime scout guys. And the level of endurance and durability to do that for 4 years is really incredible to me, and something that I think needs to be pointed out.
The weather was a factor in this one, and that fit right into the offensive mentality of this Yale team.
Yeah, you know, the only thing that I would tell you is thank goodness all we did was run the ball. If we ever had to throw the ball on a sunny day, how about if we had to do it on a rainy day? You know, that was just our offense is ground and pound, and just get after it. And, you know, with the Toads, you know, they were just phenomenal. You know, everybody talks about the Toads, but I don't know how much airplay Coach Estock gets and his sense of intensity and what he brought every single day. And just the level of respect that the Toads had and still have to this day.
And Rich, for our viewers that are not familiar with the Toads, can you identify that group?
The offensive line.
That is Rich Toryikian, honorary Toad and junior tight end on the 1990 Yale football team. Our re-air of Yale and Princeton continues. More guests are coming up shortly.
More time on the ISO plays inside and the cutbacks.
Second down. 8-2 on the previous play. Callahan, and that Princeton defense stiffening once again. It'll be third down, gain of maybe a yard on that play.
You know, when Princeton goes off on the sideline, their coaching staff after the last series, Yale drives all the way down, just coming straight at them, no option, no misdirection. They've got to make some adjustments then to say, hey, stop the plays inside now and make them go back to the outside.
Third down coming up, about 6 yards to go for Yale. Kehler and company, it's a little bit more than five. Kehler on the roll. Gonna keep it himself. Lunges for the first down across the 35-yard line out near the 37.
You know, that's set up like a rollout pass play, but I guarantee you Darin Kehler's thinking run all the way. So what it turns out to be really is like a quarterback sweep. You get three running backs out in front of the quarterback, get to the outside and let him run. Powerhouse quarterback sweep to the outside, gets the first down.
You mentioned the option, the problems you have on the option. Not only a matter of handling the football, but the running backs making those quick cuts off the flanks. First down now, the 37-yard line of Yale. Corey, the fullback. Rugged runner out across the 40 to the 42-yard line. Looked to be a gain of almost 5 yards. They untangle from the mud. Under 3 minutes to go in this third period of play. Yale in blue.
Sort
leading
of.
Princeton. Leading Princeton in white, or at least they started the game in a white. By the score of 14-7.
You can see kind of how dark it's getting as you look up at the scoreboard. It's really getting dark down there on the field right now.
Kehler. Gouveia. Out to about the 46-yard line, and he's about a yard short of that first down. Drew made the tackle on the play. Coming up NFL Game Day. First and last word for your football Sundays, NFL Game Day, NFL Primetime. The hour-long Emmy Award-winning NFL Game Day is first to hit the field at a new time, noon Eastern, to give you television's most comprehensive look at all the day's action coming up at the NFL. They're close enough for a measurement here. Yale didn't think it had the first down. And
that just shows you those guys
time.
Are ready to play.
Yes, sir.
You know, they want to get back up there and get after it. They don't even pay attention to the fact there's a measurement going on. They just want to keep playing.
If you're wondering on a wet track how these teams do, Yale played at Dartmouth on a monsoon-like afternoon and lost. And so far, they've had the better of it here this afternoon, leading 14-7. Had great weather throughout the Ivy League and our telecast thus far this season for the most part. I think Mother Nature has conspired to show us all of her power here today. It's third down, less than a yard to go.
Come on, you Tom. Come on, Tom. Come on,
Callahan's got a lot more than he needed for the first down. He's to the 46-yard line of Princeton. First down for Yale.
You know, Wayne, you talked about the fact that Yale did play in the mud already this year and lost. Well, sure, they did lose to Dartmouth in a tough game, but the other side of that is they've been in these conditions already once this year. It was just this wet. Coach Koza talked about the fact you couldn't see jersey numbers. It was a total mud out. They've been there before. Princeton hasn't played in a game like this season, so Yale comes in with a little bit more experience in these conditions.
First down from the 46 of Princeton. Kehler got him. Yassine Shabazz, and he makes the catch inside the 30 at the 26-yard line. Trevor Crossan forced him out. 20-yard gain.
Look at the guy coming back with mud all over his face and all over his neck and down inside his shoulder pads. That's tough. You see Kehler roll out. They're not afraid to throw it. They're just going with their offense. A great catch here by Shabazz. See him jump up and catch it in his hands. That's what you love a receiver to do. Catch it at the highest point. He's going to go up there and not let anybody else have it. Right in the hands. Great catch, and there's where he takes the face plant in the mud.
First down, just outside the 25-yard line of Princeton. Yale on the drive, leading 14-7. Kehler caught from behind by Newsom and thrown down of the play. Leon Newsom.
I think it's very tough to run the option today. Kehler just doesn't have his feet under him in that kind of mud. I'm surprised in a bit that Yale keeps trying to run it, because when they run it, Prince is doing a good job of just sort of managing the blocks, stretching it out to the outside. And it's very difficult for Kehler to cut back to the inside in this turf.
Time is winding down, under a minute to go, as you can see on that scoreboard clock. Scoreboard was installed here at the Yale Bowl back in the 50s. Second down. Inside the 20 to the 18-yard line. Trevor Crossan on the stop. Penalty marker is down. Holding the call against Yale. Let's go to the studio and Tim Brando for a quick update.
All right, Wayne. Number one, Notre Dame with a touchdown pass 59 yards from Meyer to Culver after a 46-yard field goal by Greg Burke of Tennessee. It is now 7-3 Irish. And Maryland and Penn State are underway, 17-10 in the third quarter. By the way, you will see Penn State and Notre Dame next week from South Bend, Indiana on ESPN. Stay with us. Let's get back to your game now, Wayne.
Thank you, Tim. Penalty backs up Yale, and Coach Koza told us it's so important when you're running a wishbone, and really so important when you're on a wet track like this, to stay on schedule. Instead of being second and five or second and four, they're facing a second down and long yardage situation, second at about 15. Time winding down, though, in this third period of play, and we will head to the final 15 minutes after these words. Second down for Yale, 15 yards to go. Bulldogs on the drive inside Princeton territory. Kehler over the top. Yassine Shabazz with another reception just outside the 10.
What they're doing is they're catching Princeton in the zone where they've got Marvin Williams, the corner, playing short, and the safety playing deep over the top. Shabazz is just running a little corner out between the zone. Watch, he'll run by Williams. Williams will settle down. He's got the flat. Then you see the safety crossing's got deep. There's a hole in between those zones. Shabazz is running the little corner out, and Kehler's throwing it on the money.
First down just outside the 10. Kehler on a delay. Callahan up the middle, down to about the 7-yard line at best. Looked to be a gain of 3.5, 4 yards. Storyline thus far, we're just underway in this fourth period of play. 14-7, of course, is the big number. That's Yale over Princeton at the moment. Yale 259 total yards through three periods. Kehler 59 on the ground, 83 through the air. He's played well here today. Princeton 107 total yards, but penalties have really wiped out some big plays for Princeton thus far in the ball game. Second down, Yale inside the Princeton 10. Kehler keeps it himself. Touchdown.
Another great offensive series for Yale. The thing that they've done well, Seven Spina, the offensive coordinator for the Yale Bulldogs, has not gone away from his offense, even though he's got really tough conditions. Not afraid to throw the football. He's not afraid to get Kehler out on the outside, especially down here near the end zone. Running on a little option, but I think Kaler's thinking run all the way. You see a great block inside. You saw number 75, Charity, get kicked out. Kehler goes into the end zone for the score.
Ed Perks is on for the point after. And he's got it successfully through the uprights. 13:58 left to go. And Yale extends its lead to 21-7.
Today's re-air of the 1990 Yale-Princeton football game has been an absolute blast, and our special guests continue with then-junior free safety Scott Wagner. And Scott, I'll start you off with the most important question. Why Yale?
Oh, man, why Yale? So I'm from Chicago and had loved and came from a high school that had was a total football factory. You were bred to play football from, 8 years on, 8 years old on. And there was a guy named Kevin Kalinich that was, God, Cal might have been like 7 years ahead of me, but Cal was a super smart guy who went to Yale and had great success. And he was like one of the guys that you wanted to be. and that's actually what drew me to Yale from a very early age. And, my high school coach, when I got in there, basically would use it as motivation of, man, if you keep your grades up and you keep working, maybe you'll have a chance to go to Yale. And fortunately, Dave Kelly came through and thought so too and ended up there. And, frankly, when you have a choice to go, the answer is yes.
You and your teammates were able to win the 1989 Ivy League championship, and that was a little bit of a surprising win, wasn't it?
It was. I mean, again, I was a sophomore, and the surprise, so the defense was loaded with a bunch of seniors who were multi-year starters and had a ton of talent. And the offense was a bunch of, frankly, unknowns and first-year starters. And good for, the coaching staff and the program. That was the unveiling of Darin Kehler and running the wishbone. And, frankly, teams didn't know what to do with us. And, watching, I was backing up both Rich Huff and Chris Brown, and so would, use the time to learn and learn scheme on both sides, and even watching how teams were surprised against us. And each week there was always another wrinkle that would pop for a big play. And it was, a scheme that people hadn't seen and weren't familiar with, some guys who were really well suited to run it. And, team was great. And then the defense was just loaded and lived up to its reputation.
Moving to your junior year in 1990, you all lost some close ball games, but got wins in the last two games of the year. And that started in this game against Princeton at a muddy Yale Bowl.
It was probably fitting that it was muddy because that year we probably played four games in the mud. And, you know, good to know we finished strong and, you know, in the last two of them. That was rewarding to beat Princeton and Harvard handily, coming on the back of just two tough losses to very good Cornell and Dartmouth teams. You know, we finished third, and it was really those three teams at the top of the league and everybody else below. And it was, you know, it was nice to be able to get big wins against Princeton and Harvard.
We talk a lot in the Yale football family about the 4 for 40 program, and how has that attitude affected you and your life and career?
The 4 for 40, I think it's great. I think it's a wonderful extension of the program. I think the current players and guys who are, you know, several years out are just going to benefit from really a little bit more structure on what's an ethos that always existed. I mean, I graduated in 92, for goodness sake, like it was a long time ago. But my best friends are the guys I played with. And the circles of people that I played with, I hold in incredibly high regard. Right. So I can go through people who aren't my closest friends, but I love and respect them. And that feeling and spirit carries through the classes. And, you know, if you say to me, gosh, somebody's associated with Yale football, they're, you know, doing everything they got at school and in the classroom, you know, it's the one organization affiliation that I'll drop anything to help somebody from that community. And I'm not alone in that. And I think it's just great, again, and it's going to benefit everybody to, you know, just formalize some of those ties that have always existed a little more. I think it's spectacular.
That was Scott Wagner, defensive back from the class of 1992. Don't go anywhere. We have one more special guest that I am sure all of you will want to hear from. Yale and Princeton continues.
Gets a tough 3 yards inside the 40 to the 39-yard line. Mike Carew on the stop for Princeton. Factor here, 21-7 Yale, 11:40 left to go. Wet field and the offense beginning to grind it out. Going to make it real tough for Princeton coming back.
Well, you know, Yale's offense is not real big. The two guys inside are not big at all, 220 and 230 at guard and center, the Michalik brothers. They're not big, but they'll fire off at you. They run that option. And what defenses aren't used to is how quick the option comes at you, and it's tough to adjust to it. It comes at you very quick, and in the weather like today, it's tough to react.
Timeout called by Yale. Quarterback Kehler not sure what the play was from the sidelines. He'll talk it over with 11:17 left to go.
This experience, it lives on our fields and in our classrooms, where every day is a test. Each moment builds on this experience and creates an environment that develops mind, body, and soul. We become part of the storied traditions of the Ivy League. This experience, it is unrivaled.
Thank you all for joining us for this re-air of the 1990 Yale-Princeton football game. Our final guest, he's a big one, and it's Darin Kehler, starting quarterback for the Yale Bulldogs in this game. Darin, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for the invite, Adam. It's a pleasure to be here.
My first question is a simple one. Why Yale?
Yale gave me a lot of opportunities. One of them, obviously, was the opportunity to play both baseball and, you know, football at the college level. And then combining that with the outstanding, you know, academics that the university offered, it really, you know, made a pretty easy decision.
When we talk about football, the story, or I guess we could call it a legend at this point, is that you had made the decision to step away from football going into your sophomore year. Then some injuries came, and you got a phone call to come back, and in doing that became a big part of Yale football history.
It really was somewhat unique because I always enjoyed football, but after having a very successful freshman season, on the baseball field, and based on the fact that, I'm 5'9", 165 pounds at the time. You know, I'm not 6'4". I'm not 220 pounds. I sort of looked at, you know, at baseball potentially having a future to go beyond college, where, size-wise, that really wasn't going to be the case in football. So that's really why I decided to, focus on baseball and try to, improve my skill set from that standpoint. And really after, I guess, the Brown game, when Bobby Verduzco got hurt, when Coach Koza had called me on Monday morning, and just asked to say, hey, we would like to invite you back. We need a quarterback. We'd, like you to join the team. It was sort of, coming from Coach Koza, kind of an offer that you couldn't, refuse. I said my biggest, concern there was, I didn't go through, the workouts in the summer and put in all of the, the sweat equity that everybody else did. So I was kind of a little, concerned as far as being accepted by the team, kind of joining at a later date. But, the team was really very open arm, from that standpoint, and being able to, to quickly kind of pick up the offense and integrate my way into it, my sophomore year. And then obviously, junior year, we really went to a full blown, wishbone and varied attack versus kind of the modified version that we used, sophomore year, because of running it more out of an eye than necessarily a true wishbone setting.
Darin, what about your skill set allowed for this transition from that power eye to the wishbone?
I had the benefit in high school. We ran what we would call a veer offense. So it's not a true wishbone, but it has, two backs, option components to it. So the concept of running an option offense wasn't new to me from that standpoint, because of my experience in high school. So really the wishbone part of it is just, adapting to the three backs and the blocking scheme that's there. But the concept of being able to read either a defensive tackle or defensive end and making decisions based on that was, something that I already had a background in.
Your junior season, you all were able to win an Ivy League championship, which ended up being Coach Koza's last. And you mentioned a little bit about it, but what was it like playing for Coach Koza and his staff?
I always thought it was a lot of fun. Obviously, I worked a lot with, Coach LaSpina as the offensive coordinator. And really with Coach Koza always having what I would consider sort of a father figure, but sort of like with, I use term quiet confidence. I mean, he was a person that you always respected. He was somebody that would always have your back and always help you, but not necessarily really a cheerleader. He wasn't, a rah-rah guy. He kind of, you saw him, you kind of had that, that stern face, but yet, still had a smile on his face. So he was kind of one of those guys where, I don't know, almost like a Bear Bryant or someone that had sort of that aura around him that, you were going to do everything you could for, the coach, but you also knew that the coach also, cared about you, but it wasn't, you weren't going to go out for beers after the game, let's put it that way.
Looking back at this 1990 Princeton game, you were playing in your last game in the Yale Bowl, but the rainy conditions played perfectly into the strengths of this running wishbone offense.
Yeah, it was a unique day with, like I said, the rain that we had and some extent lack of footing that was there, but that was always an advantage of saying we knew where we were going, the defender didn't. So that was always a nice feeling where they didn't have as great a footing, and you could kind of put them on their heels a little bit.
Darin, this Yale football family is exactly that, a family. And Coach Reno talks about making a 40-year decision, not a 4-year decision. How has that mentality affected your life and career after football?
I think that obviously, you know, was one of the reasons that, you know, when we asked the question early on about, you know, why Yale, I mean, you are making a decision that's going to impact you for, you know, your lifetime. And, you know, the thing that I didn't even know at that time is, you know, what you mentioned as far as the family, you know, the emails that are still passed back and forth and shared among, you know, the entire team members, particularly, you know, with the 89 team that won, you know, the championship. And, you know, getting back together, obviously, you know, this year doesn't kind of work out with the pandemic, but, you know, being able to go back, you know, to the bowl on games like the Princeton or Harvard weekend and, you know, see so many teammates that are there, you know, continuing to support the program and quite frankly, picking up talking with them as if it was, you know, senior year in college yet, that bond, that camaraderie really is something that didn't really, you know, anticipate, didn't really expect per se, but, you know, when you actually see it in action, you know, you realize what a true, you know, family and a true support system, you know, at the athletic level is all about.
Darin, thank you for your time and your insight. And it has just been incredible to watch you guys run the football all over the Princeton Tigers.
Thank you, Evan.
That was Darin Kehler, quarterback of the 1990 Yale football team. Don't go anywhere. The conclusion of Yale and Princeton is coming up.
At this point in the game, with the conditions as they are, it'd be tough to come in, even if it was a dry, nice day. In these conditions, very difficult.
So they're backed up first and long. And again, Yale comes off sides. And let's go to Tim Brando.
All right, Wayne, thank you. Ohio State, after a blocked punt, takes over. Still time remaining, as we told you earlier. Fried a Bobby Olive touchdown. And Ohio State very much in the fray. 26-21, they lead by 5 to the Hawkeyes of Hayden Fry.
Hey, Wayne, I'm not sure I've ever seen this. 3 consecutive procedure penalties on Princeton's offensive line. They've walked them back themselves back 15 yards. It's first and 25.
O'Gara now try to get off a snap. Bobble the snap for a moment, slips a bit. Looks to throw under pressure and swings away. Throwing it back against the grain. Out to the 35-yard line. Eric Hamilton, the receiver.
You got a flag down.
Another penalty marker down, yep.
You're probably going to get an illegal man downfield.
That's the call, illegal man downfield.
When your quarterback shakes free like that and starts to run up the field, it's pretty tough for an offensive lineman to know whether he's going to throw the ball or not. He starts to release. Plus, shoot, we can't even see the lines on the field. He's not sure if he crossed the line or not. The penalty, 4 consecutive penalties now for Princeton. That one taking out away a gain upfield.
So Chad Roguer's start has been a troubled one indeed in this football game with 8 minutes now straight up to go. Yale leading 28-7. Penalty marked off once again, and the indication for illegal man downfield or ineligible receiver downfield. It's first in a bunch. First in about a mile and a half maybe?
Yeah, a mile and a half.
It's so dark down there in the field, I don't know if they could see the first down marker. It's that far away.
Well, Princeton right now, they just want to get a positive play in here. They don't care how many yards they get. They just like to get some.
All right, what is it? We're working on 4 consecutive penalties for Princeton now. First down and a bunch. Quick handoff to the fullback, Hallahan, and he picks up a couple of yards, positive yards, though. Gain of about 3 yards at the best. Over to make the tackle, Kevin Skull.
Roguer has struggled with every snap from center. Every one he's had to sort of re-clutch, re-grab before he's able to pull away from the center. They've got to get something going. He and Crockett, number 60, have got to get a moment, some communication going in there and get that snap center exchange working.
On second down, still long. Roguer. lots of time to throw. His receiver fell down. Pass intended for Hamilton on the sidelines. See if we can pick up what the problem might be on the snap once again.
Watch him. Even on this play, you'll see him. He'll sort of re-grab it. He has to really concentrate on getting the ball. It's just a matter of conditions. Very tough to get it done. He's trying to look deep upfield and changes his mind late to throw to the flat. And you just can't do that. He wasn't over his feet, wasn't balanced, and his throw out there was short.
Third down to 27 for Princeton. Roger. Intended for Tarkenton. Nearly picked away by Eric Drury. So it is a fourth down for Princeton.
What the hell is that?
And a very discouraging sequence of plays for the Tigers.
Yeah, that's about as bad as it gets. You get the four consecutive penalties and then the struggle just to try to get the ball upfield. The incomplete passes and now they're punting.
Watson punt formation. His kick allowed to take a Princeton hop inside the 40 down near the 35-yard line, where Yale will take over with 6:51 left to go. Coming up later today here on ESPN, again, we've got a couple of good ones for you. BYU and Wyoming, 8th-ranked Cougars against the number 25-ranked Cowboys, and then the shootout in the Southwest, Houston against Texas. And next week, Minnesota-Michigan begins our triple header, followed by Penn State, Notre Dame, and Georgia Auburn. Join us next week, 12:30 Eastern. College football. Quarterback in the ball game, Bob Verduzco. His brother Jason is the quarterback. His cousin Jason is the quarterback at Illinois. Gouveia appears to have a first down as he stretches across the 45-yard line. Mike Haru on the stop for Princeton.
Interesting story about Verduzco. You know, a couple years ago, he was the starting quarterback at Yale and took a bad knee injury. Since that time, he has had 8 operations on his knee of various kinds trying to get that thing back. They really didn't expect Verduzco to come back and play quarterback, but he just keeps coming out for the team and keeps coming out there, and now he's playing out here today. 8 knee operations on one knee.
Spot of the ball leaves Yale less than a yard from the first down. Mark it right at the 45-yard line. Snap has fumbled briefly. Not a whole lot there for David Kelly on his first carry of the afternoon. But he may have enough for the first down, and apparently he does. He only needed about a yard, and that's what he got to the 46.
You know, what that tells you is that Yale's not going to be running the option very much to finish off this game, because Verduzco just doesn't have the mobility on that left knee. See more handoffs. Carm Koza, feeling safely ahead, wants to get Darin Kehler out of the game, doesn't want to risk him getting hurt. He takes a hit on every play in the option-type offense, doesn't want to see Darin go down with an injury.
Well, they've got the big one coming up next week at Harvard. First down for Yale. Hard-hitting run by Scott Craven. Picks up maybe 2. Let's go back to the studio and Tim Brando.
In a game that means a great deal to Michigan, really not much to Illinois, although the Big Ten standings are obviously going to be affected by it. Michigan winning 22-17 today. J.D. Carlson ties a Michigan record with 5 field goals. And Georgia Tech's Scott Sisson has kicked a 33-yard field goal. It is now 3-3 Virginia Tech and Georgia Tech with under 4 minutes remaining in that game. We will keep you posted, Wayne.
Thank you, Tim. Second down. About 9. Kelly inside Tiger territory, about the 48-yard line. Gain of about 4 or 5 yards on that play. Wade Wilson, the defensive back, on the stop. Under 5 minutes to go in the football game. Yale leading impressively, 28-7. Penalties have really scarred the effort for Princeton here this afternoon, and taking them out of field position, taking them out of big offensive plays. It would have given them some momentum when the game was hanging in the balance. Verduzco again on the give to Kelly. Hard-hitting move off right guard on a counter. And he picks up yardage close to the 45, where it'll be a fourth down. Coming on the punting unit, Greg Bowman. Day like today.
I was going to say, are you surprised they're punting here?
Yeah. fourth down and about 2 yards to go. 3:44 left to go. Wade Wilson back in single safety. Greg Bowman. That's the snap. Oh, and it partially blocked, or so it appeared. Takes a Yale bounce down to the 30-yard line. And it'll be first down for Princeton at the 30-yard line. Coming up, season premiere tomorrow night of NFL football, San Francisco 49ers, Joe Montana and company against Jimmy Johnson's Dallas Cowboys, 8 o'clock Eastern time here on ESPN. The start of Sunday night football on ESPN. First down now. Princeton on the attack. Football near the 30-yard line. Snap is fumbled, up for grabs. Yale has the football. Coming away with it, Greg Hammer. So the problems continue for the Tigers. Number 48, Hammer on the recovery.
Darin Kehler, 104 yards passing, 67 rushing yards, and 3 touchdowns. Showed you why today he's the man for the Yale offense. As you saw a little celebrating, Yasin Shabazz, you know, made some good catches in the third
quarter. Sure did. As Yale broke it open, we were tied at 7 at halftime, and Yale in the second half with 3 scores on the board. Steve Tashus, a coach at Princeton, dejected on the sidelines, his team unable to put anything together today. New quarterback of the game is Phil Sullivan.
Flag of the play is a false start. We'll mark 5 yards off for Yale. Paul Sullivan. He's more of an option kind of guy. He'll run the option. He's got good mobility. The Yale coaches told us coming into the game that if we saw Sullivan, they could probably stay with their offense. If we saw Verduzco, you'd see more of a passing game. You're obviously not going to see a passing game now at this point of the game or in these conditions, and Sullivan's in the ballgame.
Football back to the 35-yard line. First down and 15. Sullivan running the option. Inside the 30 to the 25. Makes a bit of a cutback move. Down to about the 20-yard line. Close to the first down. Looked to be a gain of 15 yards.
Same play that Darin Kehler worked so effectively, that lead option with a blocker out in front of him, then going out to the outside. It ends up looking almost like a power sweep to the quarterback. He's got that chance to pitch it out to the outside if he needs to. But great blocking there and great job upfield. And we go to a new quarterback. Number 19, Clint Alexander, comes into the ballgame. He's a transfer from Duke. Sat out last year, was a scholarship player at Duke, now comes up to Yale. He's getting his first shot right now in this ballgame.
Clint Alexander, second down, a little bit less than a yard to go. Escaping to the outside, Scott Craven's got the first down and then some. Inside the 20 to about the 15-yard line. Well, you know, at Harvard we saw, what, about 4 or 5 quarterbacks in the final minute or two of play as Joe Restic got his quarterback roster into the game.
And they were alternating them every play in that ball game. He had one guy going in after each play. I think they're sort of alternating by series right now.
And Alexander is on now for Yale on first down. Yeah, Raven again. Short yardage there inside the 15 to about the 14-yard line. Scott Craven, a senior from Potomac, Maryland. Switched from running back to wide receiver and back to running back in his Harvard, Yale career. Yale and Harvard next week, that's the big game that everyone talks about in the Ivy League, but really Dartmouth and Cornell have been dueling for the Ivy Championship, and of course that's what everyone shoots for at the beginning of the season. Second down. Hole out there at all for Nick Corbo, the tailback slash defensive back. He plays on both sides of the football.
Nice play by James Lowry coming up from the cornerback spot, making the tackle on the outside. Interesting story about James. You know, in junior high school, he was a figure skater. You know, you don't see many competitive figure skaters. He was a statewide, almost a nationally ranked figure skater. Got away from the figure skating when he got into high school and decided to play some football. Trying to do a little adjustment to his helmet there, and now he's going to have to come out of the game. The equipment's not working. But a nice play by Lauer. He got a piece of a punt earlier in the ballgame.
Third down and about 10 yards to go. Alexander looking to the air. Into the end zone, got a man wide open for the touchdown! Eli Cooper!
He's got the right first name for it, doesn't he?
Sure does.
Clint Alexander is known to be a very excellent drop-back passer. That's why he was recruited at Duke. He shows his ability there, dropping straight back and throwing a nice pass across the middle. I must admit, I'm a little surprised by the call. They went for the touchdown there with a minute to go and a 28-7 lead. But a nice pass and catch, and Eli Cooper gets a touchdown.
For the Elis. Extra point try. And it's blocked. Peter Schwartz, extra point try is blocked into the end zone.
You see,
and picked up now. They can run it back. Raven coming out of there with it. They'll have to make a play on him. Or it could be a two-point score the other way. And they stop him near the 30-yard line.
And Trevor Cross is a little tired, too. If he can run all the way up the field, as you said, 100 yards away, Princeton will get 2 points. So you look at the touchdown. Watch Alexander, the quarterback. Fake handoff, drops back, sets up. Great delivery here across the middle. And you see the nice catch right in the end zone. Protects it well. Number 8, Eli Cooper with the score. He's pretty psyched. I think that's his first touchdown. Little play action. Alexander standing tall in the pocket, just drops the ball right into the end zone. Cooper makes the catch.
4 second half scores by Yale, and Eli blown it wide open, 34-7. 6-play, 30-yard drive.
Yeah,
that Tosh is on the sidelines. That posture pretty much in the look on his face tells it all.
He's not a happy coach. Not a happy coach at all. Came out, played pretty well in the first half. It was a good game, fought pretty hard. Princeton had trouble establishing the ground game. They only had 14 yards at the end of the first half. They'd gotten some breaks, but they just had too many penalties. They had a lot of games taken away on first down with penalties, and Yale just came out and just did a great job in the second half and beat them up. As you saw, you know, we talked about Perks earlier in the ballgame. He's the field goal and extra point kicker for Yale. Got the record for the number of consecutive PATs. Well, that record's over now.
No, Peter Schwartz kicked that extra point.
Oh, okay.
Peter Schwartz, so the record is intact.
Oh, okay, they took Perks out. Didn't want to damage the chances at him. Didn't want him to lose that record, so the block kick does not affect Perks' consecutive PAT record.
Peter Schwartz has it on the team. May need some assistance. There are the deep backs.
All the boys are confident. Out!
Lurch on the far side of back deep. Wilson was on the near side, and now Schwartz ready to restart the game. Take it by one of the up backs. Dan Benz across the 25 to about the 30-yard line. This is the final game to be played on the Yale Bowl field this season. And from the looks of the field, it's going to take all of the offseason to get it back into shape for next
year. I take it back, Wayne. That looks like a lot of fun right there. You know, you've been giving me a hard time all game. I wish I were down there slugging it around in the mud right now.
Yeah, okay. We've still got time, Kevin. Do you have any eligibility left? Roguer back to throw. It's his man out of the backfield and across the 40-yard line. Lorenzo Bivens forced out, picking up a first down. Coming up, Tim and Lee, the college football scoreboard. Get you up to date on what's going on in college football. And then our triple header of action continues. BYU and Wyoming, our next game. That to be followed by Houston at Texas. First down for Princeton. Just across the 40-yard line of the Tigers. Chad Roguer, there's lots of time, outlets it into the flat, First down long.
There's Doug Massick, number 35, out on the second string fullback coming in there. Actually, 39. Excuse me. That's Josh Rudolph.
Josh Rudolph, yep.
Josh Rudolph making the catch. Rogier goes to his about fourth receiver there. Wanted to throw it left and look deep up the field, then dumped it off to Rudolph and got the first down.
First and 10 for Princeton. Gare stumbles a bit, but has time. Drills the pass in there to Tarkenton. Inside the 30-yard line near the 29. 11 seconds left to go. They stop the clock with 11 seconds left to go to reset the chains. Roguer moving the offense here in the concluding seconds of this ball game. Really, it's all academic because Yale is in firm control. Roguer with time winding down. Pass overthrown near the 10-yard line. 2 seconds left to be played. 2 seconds remaining.
Incomplete pass obviously stops the clock. So Princeton will have one more shot to go into the end zone to try to get 14 points on the board, give Roguer an opportunity to throw the ball around a little bit.
Last play of the game. Roguer. Pass incomplete as time winds down. Impressive victory for Yale. In the mud and wind and rain, a 34-7 victory over Princeton. We'll be back to wrap it up. Wayne Larrabee, Kevin Guthrie. That's the final, Yale over Princeton. Yale has the big one with Harvard coming up next week to close the season.
You know, you come into a game in this kind of weather, you don't expect big plays to happen in the air and through gambling plays, but you get the deep pass across the middle to Shabazz. This was the first touchdown Yale got in the second half, gave them the 14-7 lead. Now the next play, the next backbreaker, is a touchdown they got to put them ahead 28-7. Halfback option in the mud. Kevin Callahan pulls up, throws into the end zone to his tight end for the score. You don't expect those kind of backbreaking plays to come on a day like this. Bit of irony there, and Yale runs away with it in the second half.
Well, this wraps up our Ivy League coverage on ESPN this year. I'd like to thank our statistician, Jeff Levine, and our spotter today, John Sargent. Kevin Guthrie, this is Wayne Larrabee saying so long from the Yale Bowl.